Next question from any brother. If a non-Muslim brother is here, we'll allow, or the next mic, there's someone. Any non-Muslim brother here? We'll allow on the next mic. Yes, brother.
I'm asking on the behalf of non-Muslim brother.
Okay, we'll allow that.
So he's like an atheist. He doesn't believe in God. And what he said, that we don't believe in Quran and you should not believe in God. Why in this 21st century you are believing in Almighty God? This in modern era, the science technology is that much higher. Then why should you believe in God? You should not believe in God. You should do what is better for human beings. Thank you.
The brother asked the question on behalf of his friend who's an atheist, that why believe in God in this age of science and technology? You know, be a good human being. Brother, the first thing I'll do is I'll congratulate your friend. Why? Because most of the human beings, unfortunately, they are doing blind belief. He's a Hindu because father is a Hindu. He's a Christian because father is a Christian. Some people are Muslim because their father is a Muslim. This friend of yours, the atheist, is thinking. He may be coming from a religious background, but he may not agree that the God which his parents worship, they are worth being called as God. So the reason I congratulate him is because he has said the first part of the Islamic Shahada, La ilaha, there is no God. The only thing I have to do is prove to do is illallah but Allah, which I shall do inshallah. So this person, half my job is done. To the other non-Muslim first, I have to prove to him the God is worshipping is false God. And then prove to him about true Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This non-Muslim is an atheist, half my job is done. He's already said the first part of the Islamic Shahada, La ilaha, there is no God. The only thing I have to do is illallah but Allah, which I shall do, inshallah. Now, since you said your friend believes in science and technology and the world is advancing, I will ask the atheist a question, that suppose an equipment is brought in front of him, who no one in the world has ever seen, and if the question is asked to your friend, that who will be the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of this equipment who no one in the world has seen? Who is the first person? And the reply he will give, he may say that the manufacturer, or he may say the inventor, or he may say the creator, or he may say the maker. Whatever he says, it will be somewhat similar. Either creator, maker, manufacturer, inventor, whatever it is, it will be similar. And the second person is, whoever the creator, inventor, manufacturer has told, he'll be the second person. But the first person would be the creator, the manufacturer, the inventor. Keep this answer at the back of your mind. And ask him the next question, that how did our universe come into existence? So he will tell you that, you know, today science has advanced and we have come to know that our universe was once a primary nebula. Then there was a big bang. There was a secondary separation which gave rise to galaxies, the stars, the sun, the moon, and the earth on which we live. When did you come to know this? So he will tell you it was in 1973 when a group of scientists, they described the Big Bang and the creation of the universe. So you tell him what you came to know hardly about 35, 36 years back is already mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 30, where he says, Avalam yaral lazina kafuru, do not the unbelievers see, anna samawati wal arda kan taratkan saknahuma, that the heaven and the earth were joined together and we clove them asunder. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran 1400 years ago? So the atheist may say, maybe it was a fluke. Don't argue. Continue. Ask him the next question. What is the shape of the earth? So he will tell you, previously, the human beings thought that the earth on which we live is flat. It was in 1579, when Sir Francis Drake, when he sailed around the earth, he proved that the earth is spherical. You came to know in 1579, hardly 400 years back. Quran mentions 1400 years ago. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Naziat, chapter number 79, verse number 30. Wal ardh ba'da zalika dahaha. And thereafter, we have made the earth egg-shaped. Dahaha, one of its meanings is an expanse, and the earth is an expanse. The other meaning is derived from the Arabic word duya, which means an egg. And it does not refer to a normal egg. And we know today that the world is not completely round like a ball. It is certain from the pole. It is geospherical in shape. And the Arabic word dahaha doesn't refer to a normal egg. It specifically refers to the egg of an ostrich. And if you analyze the shape of an egg of an ostrich, that too is geospherical in shape. Imagine, the Quran speaks about the geospherical shape of the earth 1400 years ago. You ask your friend, who could have mentioned this in the Quran? He will say, oh, maybe your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he was an intelligent man. Don't argue, continue. You ask him, that the light of the moon, is it its own light or reflected light? So he will tell you that previously we human beings thought that the light of the moon is its own light. Recently in science, 100 years back, 200 years back, 300 years back, we came to know that the light of the moon is not its own light, it's a reflected light. What you came to know recently is mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 61. The Quran says, the light of the sun is its own light and the light of the moon is described as munir or noor, meaning borrowed light or reflection of light. So who could have mentioned that the light of the moon is not its own light but reflected light 1400 years ago? He may give a pause and say, okay, maybe your prophet was very, very intelligent. Don't argue. Continue. I learned in school that the sun, though it revolved in the solar system, in the galaxy, it did not rotate about its own axis. Is that what is mentioned in the Quran? No, that is what I learned in school. We were in 1982, 27 years back, I had learned that the sun was stationary. But Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 33, Huwa allazi khalaqa al-layla wan-nahara. It is Allah who has created the night and the day, wa shamsa wal-qamar, the sun and the moon, kullun fi falakin yasbahun, each one traveling in orbit with its own motion. That is because yasbahun means it describes the motion of a moving body. So Quran says the sun and the moon, besides revolving, it even rotates about its own axis. And today science has come to know that the sun takes approximately 25 days to complete one rotation. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran 49 years back, which we came to know recently, hardly 20 years back, 30 years back? He'll give a pause. Don't wait for the answer. You can continue. Quran speaks about that the sky, Almighty God, has made a protected ceiling. Without it, life cannot exist on the face of the earth. In Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 32, Quran speaks about water cycle in several places in the Quran. In Surah Az-Zumur, chapter 39, verse number 21. In Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse 24. In Surah Hijr, chapter 15, verse 22. In Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse number 18. In Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 40. In Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse 57. Several places, the Quran speaks about the water cycle in great detail. Who could have mentioned this 14 years back? He'll give a pause. Don't argue. Keep on continuing. Quran speaks about biology, that we have created every living thing from water. Quran speaks about botany, that we have created every plant in pairs, two and two, in sexes, male or female, in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 53. Quran speaks about that the animals have been created from water. Surah Nur, chapter 24, verse number 45. Quran speaks about that human beings have been created from water. Surah Furqan, chapter 25, verse number 54. The Quran speaks about genetics, that it is a male fluid which is responsible for determining the sex of the child. In Surah Najm, chapter number 53, verse number 45, 46. And Surah Qiyamah, chapter number 75, verse number 37 to 39. The Quran speaks about embryology. The Quran speaks about geology. The Quran speaks about oceanology. You can give a talk for us together. After every scientific sign mentioned in the Quran, ask your friend, who could have mentioned this in the Quran 14 years back? The only reply I can give you is the creator, the manufacturer, the maker, the inventor. This creator, this manufacturer, this inventor, we Muslims call as Allah, we call him God. So today, science is not eliminating God, it is eliminating models of God. La ilaha illallah. That's the reason a famous philosopher by the name of Francis Bacon said, little knowledge of science makes you an atheist, but in-depth knowledge of science brings you closer to Almighty God. So you can ask your friend to see my video cassette, Is the Quran God's Word? And Quran Modern Science, in which there are various other proofs talking about the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hope that answers the question.